This is the new Ferrari Daytona SP3. The design, I think it looks fantastic. It's an homage. Basically, it was inspired by the racing Ferraris and some Ferrari prototypes from the late 60s and early 70s. The design is excellent, like I said, but the Lego had to sacrifice, let's say, structural rigidity. It has a similar problem like the real cars, because this is a spider, which means it's open top. This means that there is no roof to make the structure stronger, so it flexes a little bit. So yeah, I think overall it's a very nice, interesting model, very good looking, so a showpiece. But Jernej also made it practical by installing BuWizz motors and BuWizz inside, and today we are testing it to see what it can do on the racetrack.
So I just wanted to talk a bit about the original set and the motorization process.
Before I start building the physical version of the motorized model, I always kind of like to make a digital version, which helps me develop the motorization model, and it allows me to predict and solve any issues I might run into. And as you can see, I'm using 8 BuWizz motors in a V configuration, similar to the one in the Chiron. And we are using 4 motors to drive each of the wheel sides. So these are left and these are right wheel drive side. And the whole model only uses 2 gears for the driveline, which is very low, and it should be very efficient. Another thing that was motorized is, of course, opening and closing of the doors. In this case, I decided to use mini linear actuators, which are driven by a few gears and a medium powered up motor. I will slightly change the suspension mounting points in the front, and I will add suspension traveling parts, limiters in the front and here in the rear, which will keep the wheels from touching the bodywork when fully compressed. Because I did remove a lot of structural important parts, I had to also reinforce the model. So in this case, since we are missing the 3x19 frames here, I am using the flip-flop beams, which are sandwiched using normal beams. And in order to give strength to the rear side of the car, I actually am using the engine cover as a structural part. So this should keep the engine from falling apart and the model's rear end from bending.
The rear axle and the front axle are almost complete, and so is the power unit, or how should we call it. So basically all the motors are prepared and everything will be going on this frame. You can see how the BuWizz units are positioned in such a way that the weight is now spread more evenly, so more towards the front. And all the BuWizz units are designed to be placed in such a way so they are easy to charge.
So the original set came with an 8-speed gearbox, which was actuated by the pedals here. In order to motorize it, I removed the gearbox, and I also did a lot of modifications to be able to fit everything inside. We have 4 motors for the left wheel drive and 4 motors for the right wheel drive, and I'm only using 2 gears to power them, which makes this model very efficient. There is another small powered up motor in the back, which is driving the fake engine, and the fake engine is in the same position as the original. The interior was also preserved, so we have the same placement of the seats, nothing changed inside. But I did actually manage to add another motor, which opens and closes the doors using mini linear actuators. I managed to increase the steering angle compared to the original, and I also increased the suspension height slightly in the front so that we are not bumping into everything in the front. And lastly, I also had to modify the whole frame of the car. Because of the additional motors, I had to reinforce the center frame of the car, because this car is the targa version, which means there is no roof holding it together, so I had to reinforce to minimize the bending in the middle. So we were testing it before and we already went over 24 kilometers an hour. The wheels are bigger than with the Chiron, but there are only 8 motors. Chiron used 12 and Chiron went, I think, 31. I expect around 30 kilometers an hour.
The best. Wow.
Okay, let's see how fast that was. So that was 25.6. So that was, yeah, it's still 25.6. So that was 26 kilometers an hour. We can go faster, but I have a problem with one of the gears. They are skipping, so we would need more. I'm gonna try to give myself more space.
Oof, oof, shit. Very high obstacle, like 4 millimeters or something like that.
Yeah, well, it's not the only thing we broke. We went over 30 kilometers an hour. So
excellent.
I'm happy with it and that's, I'm gonna great. Keep it there. Okay, and now that we are fixing the car, I'm also gonna fix the gears we broke before. When we were testing the model earlier, the rubber came off the rim and the wheel got lodged and the teeth got, you can see a few teeth here, got damaged. I'm really happy how fast the model actually goes, because I was expecting around 30 kilometers an hour. Even though the wheels are slightly bigger than the Chiron, we are only using 8 motors, and because of the new system that we are using to hold the wheels, we do have a bit more friction. So I'm really happy that we still managed to go over 30 kilometers an hour. This is the fourth licensed supercar from Lego. It has quite a few improvements compared to the old ones, but there are also some things that are have not been improved. The big major improvement is the larger wheels, in my opinion, because they give us much more space inside to put more mechanical suspension components inside. Another big improvement is the styling. We have many more new panels, so this allows us to make even more complex and organic shapes. Other than that, there weren't really many innovations when it came to mechanics. The model used, the original model used the same gearbox as the Lamborghini, and it only comes with rear-wheel drive, just like the original model. So there weren't that many improvements in regards to the gearbox and transmission. One major improvement compared to the old ones that I almost forgot to mention is the use of the new shock absorbers. The new shock absorbers were first used in the BMW motorbike. They're the really big, really strong ones, and they are really useful because no longer we have to rely on using 8 small shock absorbers. Now we can use 8 big ones, and this gives the model much cleaner look and it simplifies the suspension. In the future, we might make a version that actually uses four-wheel drive, or we might actually make a simplified version with the rear section completely original and with only front wheel drive and buoys in the front, so we can still have the best of both worlds. So we can still have the working gearbox and the motorized wheel drive. We just came from driving our Ferrari outside. We reached 30 kilometers an hour, and here's just a quick footage on the test bench. Sounds nice, huh? So I just wanted to take a few minutes to talk about the wheels of the model. So basically, as you can see, we are not using original Lego wheels, because from our last experiences with them, they just kept falling off the hubs. So Lego uses three pins to hold the wheel on the hub, and as soon as you apply a load that is too large for the wheel to handle, it simply falls off. And we had those issues when we were comparing the supercars, and that's why I decided to do something differently. With the Spano, we used 3D printed wheels, which held to the hubs much better, but we still had a weak point, which was that the hub would simply fall apart. Especially at high speeds, we had footage of driving at high speeds and the wheels would just fall off, and either they were falling off because of the pins or they were falling off because of the hub. And for the Ferrari, we decided to use the mini turntables instead of the usual Lego hubs. Now, the mini turntables have a few advantages compared to this Lego hub. One of those is the attachment points. So, with this design, the pins that are holding the wheel are attached perpendicularly and go through the wheel and through the turntable. This makes it impossible for the wheel to be removed by force. And another good advantage is that because of this turntable's design, they are designed to have much less slack than the normal hubs. And you can easily see this here. So you can see how much this can wobble. And now compared to our solution, there is much less wobbling, which is very important when we are driving cars at high speed, because you need the suspension and all the mechanical things to be as stiff and without slack as much as possible. And this comes to play here. You can see just how well this wheel is attached to the Ferrari. It's not bending much at all. And the same in the steering system. And this allowed this model to be much more precise when driving. So another thing that this solution allowed us is to print our own brake discs. Now, the original brake discs that were included with the Ferrari are around 42 millimeters diameter. And if you look at the wheel, they look kind of lost in there. So I decided to increase the brake discs to around 50 millimeters. So you can see the size difference here. And this gives the model much more aggressive look.
So your neighbor challenged me to try to take these hubs apart. So this is the original hub. Let's see if this is, it turns. Let's see. Yeah, goes apart pretty easily. Now let's try this one. Nope, no way. Ah, yeah. Okay, but it was a lot of force and I didn't take the hub. Actually, the hub fall apart, but it was a lot of force. The only downside to the new hubs is that they have a little bit more friction compared to the old hubs, but this is overcome by greasing the hub with silicone grease, and I would say that the positives outweigh the negatives in this case. So yeah, I think this your nice idea to make these hubs was really great. I see the friction is not so bad.
So the only problem we had outside with the wheels were the tires actually fell off two times, and that can be remedied in the future by increasing the size of these channels. So I can make them even bigger, and this will reduce the probability of the tires falling off. So if you would like to see us push the boundaries even further in the future, please remember to subscribe and hit the notification bell.
We're gonna keep doing videos like this, and yeah, I mean, it's great fun for us to film the videos, and hopefully it's also great fun for you to watch them.